January 1961, a new American president, the firstborn of the 20th century, takes office.
Let the word go forth from this time and place to friend and foe alike that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans born in this century.
During the election campaign, John Kennedy had promised to get America moving again. He had made a major issue of missile and space gaps, gaps he believed had left American technology dangerously behind the Soviet Union. Even before the inauguration, Kennedy's science advisors called for a sweeping reorganization of the nation's space program, an effort now centered around putting a man in space. Project Mercury, as it is called, is assessed as marginal and potentially dangerous. Politically, the future of America's manned space program is in doubt before it has a chance to get off the ground. But even that has proved no easy matter. Former Mercury astronaut John Glenn.
They asked, what were you thinking about when you got ready to launch? And I think a standard answer for all the group has become, how do you think you'd feel if you knew you were on top of that thing built by the lowest bidder on a government contract?
Other mishaps are not nearly as spectacular, but just as embarrassing. Mercury flight director Chris Kraft on his first Redstone missile launch.
The thing I remember most about it was that when it lit off, I saw this big pile of smoke, and I'd never seen a Redstone launch before from the flight director's seat, and I had a television screen in front of me, and this smoke and I went and I saw this thing clear the television screen, and I thought it was a missile. It wasn't a missile. It was all our escape rocket went off. And I said, my God, look at the acceleration. And then the smoke cleared, and the missile was still there. And I was really shocked by all that. I remember it was quite a bad day.
With the National Aeronautics and Space Administration facing a very uncertain future, no one is interested in running the agency. In frustration, Kennedy turns to his vice president, Lyndon Johnson. A longtime advocate of an aggressive space program from his days in the Senate, Johnson is given the task of finding someone to run NASA. His choice is James Webb. But like others who have already turned down the job, Webb balks at the offer. Webb's close friend and builder of the Atlas missile, Frank Pace.
And he did indeed talk to me, and he did not want it. I had known the vice president, to whom this responsibility had been assigned by the president, quite well. And Jim said, you know, it's very difficult to dissuade Lyndon Johnson once he's set his mind. I said, you have not stated it quite accurately. It's somewhere between difficult and impossible. Well, he said, why don't you have a try at the impossible? Well, I said, I wouldn't do it for anybody but you, but I will. So I went to see the vice president, and I said, as you know, Mr. Vice President, Jim and I are very close friends. This is an assignment that he questions that he can handle, and there's also the question of his health. I'm not sure the vice president even heard me, because he said, listen, Frank, he said, Jim Webb is not only the best man, he is the only man to head it, and he is going to. I'll see you later. I went out with my tail between my legs, but I recovered sufficiently to say, Jim, congratulations, you got the job. He said, thanks.
In the Soviet Union, Premier Nikita Khrushchev already has in place the man who will run Russia's space program. His name is Sergei Korolev, but during his lifetime, he is never identified. The Soviets refer to him only as the chief designer. By the beginning of the 60s, Kuryov had already brought much attention and credit to Khrushchev and the Soviet Union. The launching of Sputnik, the world's first satellite, had surprised the entire world in 1957. By 1959, the Soviets had reached the moon and photographed its backside with a mechanical probe. These were widely publicized achievements, but what was not shared with the world was what Soviet space observer Jim Oberg believes was Russia's first space disaster, an accident that still today has never been confirmed or denied by Western intelligence.
One particular catastrophe that was definitely caused by political pressure involved a space shot while Khrushchev was pounding his shoe at the United Nations back in October 1960. This was a case where a rocket was supposed to be fired, but it didn't fire when the button was pushed. So the general in charge ordered the people out to the launch pad to check out the missile. The safe thing to do is to wait and drain the propellants out and wait several hours. And an explosion occurred, and dozens of people, including the general, were killed. Korolev himself was probably there, probably at the launch pad in the bunker, and escaped death only by a hair's breadth.
Despite the dangers, both Soviet and American test pilots push ahead in their race to be the first in space. For both countries, much of their training centers around the possible adverse effects of weightlessness. In America, the competition is among seven ambitious young men, the Mercury astronauts. Alan Shepard.
I don't think it would be a surprise to you to find out that there was a tremendous amount of competition. It was a situation in which there had been competition in the selection process. It was interesting in that that all of us did work together in the engineering aspects of it. We each had separate assignments, and we would have meetings and bring in things that we had discovered or learned or redesigned or changed during the early days. So there was a camaraderie associated with that, but on the other hand, each one of us knew that only one guy was going to have the first flight, so the competition was there, underlying everything.
Despite the internal rivalry, the American astronauts closed ranks on rating the Mercury spacecraft. The capsule was originally designed to fly automatically, leaving the astronaut little more than a passenger. But with seven test pilots, the issue becomes, who will have control? Deke Slayton.
When we came on board, of course, there was one little porthole in down by a hatch, and the hatch screwed on. There was no way to get it off except 90 to 100 screws in the darn thing that had to be put on for launch and taken off to get you out of there post-launch. So the first three things we did, we got a window put in up in front of the pilot so he could see and effectively control the machine, have some visibility to control it. Then we had a control system in it that allowed us to control it. And then the third thing was we got a hatch that would blow off so you could get out of the darn thing. It was going higher, it was going faster, and even though it was designed at that time to operate totally unmanned, and did operate unmanned, of course, the first couple flights with chimps in them, as a matter of fact. And we got used to being chimps for the test pilots, and we were the guys following behind, kind of a thing, you know, which rankled people a little bit.
This chimpanzee who was flying in space took off at 10:08. He reports that everything is perfect and working well.
We had a lot of interesting times then because we had a mishap in that flight that caused the spacecraft to land several 150 miles or so downrange from where we had intended to pick it up, and it was about to sink when we got there, and the monkey was very unhappy about having been hit in the fanny with 17G, and he quit working for a while, and it messed up our equipment, and the equipment was shocking him when it shouldn't have been shocking him, and we had a very unhappy monkey or chimpanzee when we got to him in the recovery operation. That was an interesting experience, because what followed that was because we couldn't convince the medical world that the chimpanzee performed okay. We couldn't convince them that man could perform okay under those circumstances, and they were insisting that we test a large number of chimpanzees to destruction in the Johnsville centrifuge.
Besides concerns about the physical consequences of space flight, there are still nagging problems with the Redstone rocket. In the meantime, on April 12, 1961, the Soviet Union launches the first man into space. Seven-year-old Yuri Gagarin of the Russian Air Force. In his automatically controlled spacecraft, Gagarin makes one complete orbit around the Earth. Less than 2 hours after launch, this new Columbus of the space age is safely recovered and returns to a hero's welcome on a global scale. America, already behind, had lost yet another lap in the race for space.
President, a member of Congress said today that he was tired of seeing the United States second to Russia in the space field. I suppose he speaks for a lot of others. What is the prospect that we will catch up with Russia and perhaps surpass Russia in this field?
However tired anybody may be, and no one is more tired than I am, it is a fact that it's going to take some time, and I think we have to recognize it. They secured these large boosters, which have led to their being first in Sputnik and led to their first putting their man in space. We are, I hope, going to be able to carry out our efforts with due regard to the problem of the life of the man involved this year. But we are behind.
Kennedy reacted rather strongly to the Gagarin flight. It was a slap in the face to him. He had come into office with the image of a young and virile and vigorous man who was going to get the country moving again. Had found the first couple of months of his administration frustrating.
Political scientist and longtime observer of America's space program, John Logsdon,
began to become aware of the growing need for some sort of U.S. involvement in Southeast Asia. Even back in early 1961, we were talking about Marines in Laos. The Gagarin flight was a positive achievement by the Soviet Union, and then just a few days later, the United States helped a group of Cuban emigres who had been kicked out by Castro to land on the beach at the Bay of Pigs and then left them to be captured or killed without the kind of U.S. air cover that they had anticipated. At the same time, the Soviets did something very positive. The United States looked like a second-rate operation in the eyes of the world.
3 weeks after Gagarin's flight, NASA prepares to launch its first astronaut into space. Alan Shepard had won the Mercury competition, but lost the global race to Gagarin. The White House, reeling from the abortive Bay of Pigs and fearing the consequences of a potential space disaster, considers postponing the first American flight. Robert Siemens, former deputy director of NASA.
Clearly, this must have been part on the mind of some in the White House, including the president. From our standpoint, we felt that we were ready to go and that the flight should take place on the schedule we had, but there certainly was concern that the flight might fail. And my understanding from Ed Welch, who was there, who was responsible for the workings of the Space Council, that when the question was asked, what will we do if it fails, he replied with a question, but supposing it succeeds?
NASA's administrator, Jim Webb, is ready for both questions. Before the launch, he prepares three possible statements for the press. One, if the flight succeeds. A second, if Shepard has to eject but survives. And a third, if the astronaut is killed. Alan Shepard.
I guess, basically, first of all, you, the pilot, are interested in, number one, does the thing have enough thrust to get it off the ground? And number two, is it going to accelerate me to the point where I'm not going to be able to cope with it during the launching phase? Having satisfied yourself that you're going to be able to do that, then really it becomes more a matter of being concerned about controlling the vehicle in the case of a malfunction rather than just the utter enormity if a Redstone blows up, you still lose your life if you don't react properly.
I think that that was the most exciting, perhaps, of all the missions. Even the first launches of Saturn going to the moon weren't quite as exciting as the mission with Shepard, because we had been seeing a lot of failures up to that time. And here now we got a man strapped to the top of that firecracker. And it was pretty scary.
See what it looked like and make some kind of profound statement.
From the periscope, what a beautiful view.
Shepard had been hurled some 116 miles into space and back to Earth on a suborbital flight lasting only 15 minutes.
Main ship is green. Main ship is coming unraised and it looks good.
In engineering terms, the mission is anticlimactic following Gagarin's orbiting flight of nearly 2 hours. But for a relieved America, it is an unqualified success.
Johnson mentioned several times, as my wife and I were riding with him in an open car down Pennsylvania Avenue going from the White House to the Congress, Capitol Hill. And there was literally hundreds of thousands of people, I don't know, just all lined the streets and waving flags. And comment by Johnson several times that I was a famous man. You know, where are all these people coming from? I thought, you're going to be famous. And finally reached the steps of the Capitol, he says, matter of fact, he says, you are a famous man, he says. And let me give you a little advice, he says. In years ahead, now that you're a public figure, let me tell you, never pass up the opportunity for a free meal or to go to the men's room. Typical Johnson.
With the success of Shepard's flight, Kennedy's administration has at last a positive American achievement.
Sir Alan Shepard, the members of the House and Senate Space Committee who are with us today, and this decoration, which has gone from the ground up here.
Recognizing the immense international prestige of space, John Kennedy makes an extraordinary public challenge to the Russians. With only 15 minutes experience in suborbital flight, Kennedy ups the ante by committing America to landing a man on the moon.
We take an additional risk by making it in full view of the world. But as shown by the feat of astronaut Shepard, this very risk enhances our stature when we are successful. But this is not merely a race. Space is open to us now, and our eagerness to share its meaning is not governed by the efforts of others. We go into space because whatever mankind must undertake, free men must fully share.
In July of 1961, Gus Grissom repeats Shepard's quarter-hour suborbital flight. The flight itself is successful, but after splashdown, the escape hatch blows prematurely. The spacecraft sinks to the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean, and Grissom nearly drowns. Whether Grissom accidentally triggered the escape hatch or it mechanically malfunctioned has never been answered. Following Grissom's flight, the Soviet Union counters with yet another impressive space achievement. Cosmonaut German Titov orbits the Earth 17 times in a flight lasting more than a day. Neither Shepard nor Grissom, launched atop a Redstone rocket, had reached orbit. That requires the larger Atlas intercontinental ballistic missile, a missile with a history of development problems. The man responsible for building the Atlas missile, Frank Pace.
Be down there at the Cape to wonder whether that thing was going to go off, to realize that we ourselves had put 40,000 different parts into it, and there were thousands more that came from other places, and that every one of them had to work to get that thing up. I got news for you. That shakes you.
I was sitting there really sweating.
It is John Glenn who will first attempt to ride atop the Atlas.
It sounds very elementary right now, but on my flight, which was the first orbital flight, the things that we were trying to determine, one of the basic things I was to come back with were measurements, hopefully, on what happens to man's senses in space flight. And there were some doctors at that time wrote very seriously about the fact that in weightlessness for a number of hours, your eyes would no longer need to be supported by the structure under the eyes here and the muscle structure there, and would your eyes change shape slowly as you're in orbit for a while, and would this wreck your vision? Some of the doctors had predicted that in the weightlessness of space flight, the fluids of your inner ear would be moving just random motions instead of being held down by gravity as they are right here. And they felt that when these random motions occurred, it might make you so nauseous you would not be able to even make an emergency re-entry if you found it necessary to do that. So I carried along with me little Tigan tablets to take if I started feeling a little queasy. And then they had designed a syringe, a needle, with a spring-loaded needle that if I found I needed this, I could take it out and take the safety catch off and hit my leg with it, and it would drive the needle through the suit into my leg and inject the fluid.
All recorders to fast, T-minus 18 seconds and counting engine start.
Godspeed, John Glenn. 10, 9, 8, 7. Roger, understand go for at least 7 orbits.
Less than an hour into the flight, Glenn experiences his first sunrise from space. As dawn approaches, he discovers himself traveling in formation with thousands of mysterious fireflies.
Yeah, I still have some of these particles that I cannot identify coming around the capsule occasionally, over.
Roger, how big are these particles? Over.
Very small. I would indicate they're of the order of a 16th of an inch or smaller. They drift by the window, and I can see them against the dark sky. Just at sunrise, there were literally thousands of them. It looked like just a myriad of stars. Over.
An hour and a half into the mission, an automatic thruster control valve begins malfunctioning. Then, a far more serious problem. A telemetry signal from the spacecraft indicates that Glenn's heat shield and landing bag are no longer locked into position. If the heat shield is loose, Glenn will burn alive as he re-enters the Earth's atmosphere. At Mercury Control, fellow astronaut Alan Shepard.
Like every other emergency that has happened, you really need to understand and verify as closely as you can what component has failed. Then how to counteract it and really not get John involved, because he had plenty of things to do. He had a full flight plan like everybody else. Not to get him involved in the decision until such time as it became necessary to make specific recommendations.
We are recommending that you leave the retro package on through the entire re-entry. Do you read?
This is Friendship 7. What is the reason for this? Do you have any reason? Over.
Not at this time. This is the judgment of safe flight.
Roger, say again your instructions, please. Over.
It didn't take any brilliant deduction to know that they were indicating that they had had a signal that something was wrong. And I was a little aggravated at the time, I guess, that they didn't just come right out and tell me what it was.
If the heat shield is loose, only the retro pack and its 3 metal straps will save Glenn from a blazing inferno. As Glenn re-enters the atmosphere, all radio contact is lost.
Go ahead, Cape. You're ground. You're going out.
We recommend that you...
And it made a very spectacular reentry from where I was, because once I had started reentry and the high heat then started burning these parts of the retro pack off, they started coming back past the window where I was looking out like this. I could see these big burning chunks coming back. And at that time, I couldn't be absolutely certain whether it was the retro pack or the heat shield that was tearing up.
This is Friendship 7. I think the pack just let go.
Friendship 7, this is Cape to your aid.
This is Friendship 7, a real fireball outside.
I can remember, though, thinking that if it's the heat shield tearing up, I'm going to feel the hot heat on my back very soon. But you keep right on working through that time period, and you're trying to damp out the motions of the spacecraft and to do the things you're supposed to be doing during reentry to keep everything under control. And so it didn't do any good to panic at that point, and that's what we had trained to do, and that's what I did.
Shoot it out and recondition at 10,800 feet and beautiful shoot.
The heat shield had held, and as John Glenn splashes down, his fame skyrockets to epic proportions as a tidal wave of patriotism rolls across the country.
I've spoken to some people in the crowd, people who were here in 1927, 35 years ago, when they had that great parade for Colonel Lindbergh, and they tell me that it was nothing like this.
I've never tried to analyze the hero bit, but whatever comes out of that comes out of it. We'd been at sort of a low point in our national morale, if you will. We'd sort of been shocked in that the Soviets had been ahead of us a little bit in the technical areas. And I think this was sort of the event that, along with Al Shepard's flight before this, the Redstone flight, of course, sort of focused attention on the fact that we're back. And we were here to stay, and we're going into space, and it was for real, and we weren't taking the back seat for anybody.
While Glenn enjoys his triumph, Deke Slayton fights a losing battle against medical doctors and NASA's administration. Scheduled for the next orbital flight, he is suddenly grounded for an erratic heart rate, a condition NASA had known about for 2 years.
Well, I was very upset, to put it mildly. I thought it was uncalled for, and I didn't believe I had a problem, and a lot of people that I had a lot of confidence in didn't think I had a problem. So I thought it was a lousy decision. Time, I still think it was a lousy decision.
Slayton is replaced by Scott Carpenter. On the second orbital flight, mission planners call for an emphasis on science rather than flight testing of the Mercury spacecraft.
I viewed, perhaps too soon on in the program, the flight as an opportunity to evaluate the new environment. But it might have been too soon. It was viewed by most of the other fellows as an experimental test flight. We were there to evaluate the machine that got us there, and my first interest was to evaluate where I was and not the machine that got me there. I was very intrigued by the particles John had seen and had called fireflies.
Almost like a light snowflake particle caught in an eddy.
Turns out they were small ice crystals that adhered to the side of the spacecraft. And I could knock them off at will and see them float by. That was a great pleasure to, you know, I had made an unknown known. I remember, of course, the excessive fuel usage, which gave everybody a much greater concern than it gave me.
With his attention focused on experiments and solving the mystery of the fireflies, Carpenter's fuel consumption exceeds the flight plan. Then an automatic stabilizing system malfunctions. Preparing for re-entry, both manual and automatic fuel systems are mistakenly left running, further consuming fuel that is now reaching a critical level.
My fuel, I hope, holds out. There is 1G.
Soon after, Carpenter sees smoke drifting through the spacecraft.
Getting a few streamers of smoke. There was the times. We're getting some pretty good oscillations now, and we're out of fuel. Looks from the sun like it might be about 45 degrees. Oh, it's coming quick. It's really going over. Think I better take a try on the drogue. Drogue out manually at 25. It's holding. Emergency flow rate on.
We had almost 40, I think 47 minutes in which, as far as we knew, he hadn't come through the blackout. He might just as well have burned up in re-entry. They knew what was going on in mission control, but they didn't tell us. And this was a public relations failure, the biggest one of the space program.
I hold the record for an overshoot. Anyway, I took the rap for that distant impact. And that's all right. That's not important in the overall scheme of scientific inquiry.
After Carpenter's re-entry on empty fuel tanks, science experiments are cut back. On the next flight, Wally Schirra concentrates on piloting skills and chalks up a textbook flight. He lands with almost pinpoint accuracy inside of the carrier Kearsarge.
You're trying to make very precise motions, not wasted motions. And if you're flying a very delicate flying machine, you find your arm is braced on your leg, and you're moving your hand on a control thing, just barely touching it. That's called a delicate touch, a light touch. And that almost tends to make one think it would be the light stuff instead of the right stuff.
The final Mercury mission is flown by Gordon Cooper. He makes 22 orbits on a flight lasting nearly a day and a half. But by the end of the flight, Cooper has lost nearly every automatic system on his spacecraft.
We had sort of an electrical fire that burned all the electrical system out. So all the electrical that was left was the one radio that was hooked right to the battery. And so I had a radio, still had radio contact, but I had wristwatch on the arm for a time. I had eyeballs out the window for attitude control. And I had the push-pull rods, opening and closing the solenoids at the little attitude control rockets for attitude control. The suit was gone, the environmental system was gone, the carbon dioxide scrubbing was gone, temperature control was gone. All of those types of things were not there anymore.
Cooper's re-entry would be a manual one all the way. He returns to Earth as all the Mercury astronauts had wanted, as a pilot in control. Despite the national adulation over the adventures of the Mercury astronauts, the Soviet Union is still far ahead in the space race. Between the American flights of Carpenter and Schirra, the Soviet Union launches two spacecraft into orbit, flying them in formation. After Cooper's flight, the first woman flies in space, cosmonaut Valentina Tereshkova. In her 48 orbits around the Earth, Tereshkova tallies more flight time in space than all the Mercury astronauts combined. A year later, in October of 1964, the Soviet Union launches a new spacecraft, the Vashkad 1, with the world's first three-man crew aboard. The Soviet Union would score yet another first in 1965 when Lieutenant Colonel Alexei Leonov performs the world's first spacewalk. As the space race continues to heat up, the second group of American astronauts is announced to the world in 1962. Test pilots who had once scoffed at the idea of a man in the can now clamor over the chance to fly to the moon. Searching for a winning edge, the Air Force sends its pilots to Charm School. Graduate Mike Collins.
Charm School. Well, the Air Force thought that not only should they prepare us to be test pilots, but if we were going to go off to NASA and be astronauts, we should have certain social skills as well. So they ran a short course. I think we came back to Washington for a couple of days, and they told us that you're supposed to wear socks like this that go on forever, and no one wants to see hairy legs, and therefore you would flunk the NASA test if you didn't have on these kinds of socks, and you had to hold your hands on your hips this way and not that way, because only, well, people you don't want to talk about hold them the other way. And so we learned a lot of useful skills such as that in charm school.
This second group of astronauts trains for the new two-man Gemini missions, a stopgap engineering measure between Mercury and Apollo. On board Gemini's first manned shakedown flight are astronauts Gus Grissom and rookie John Young.
The Gemini was very small and compact. For a while there, we called it the Gus-mobile because Gus was really the only guy who could get in it and close a hatch without hitting him on top of the head. It was that crowded. It was like sitting sideways in a phone booth. It was really tight. It was a pilot spaceship. Every control in there was right at your fingertips. The displays were just optimum for the job that we had to do, which was ascent, entry, and rendezvous.
Ignition. Lift off.
But would it fly? Young and Grissom's task is to find out. They perform a new space first by using thrusters to change their orbit. This maneuver is the secret to rendezvous, docking, and reaching the moon. Young has also brought another secret with him into space, an unauthorized and smuggled sandwich.
Well, we're over the middle of the Pacific Ocean on our one night orbital pass. The sensors that we're using to align the platform weren't working right, so we weren't getting a good platform alignment. Of course, Gus was somewhat nervous about that because we knew if we didn't have the platform aligned properly, when we fired the retro rockets, we might be pointed in the wrong direction, which would leave you up there for a long time. So we're very nervous about that. And as we came over that part of the ocean, I knew that until we got in daylight and could see which way we were supposed to be aligned, it was really no sense worrying about it. So I handed Gus a corned beef sandwich and said, here, try this while you're thinking about how to get this platform aligned. And he said I'd get in a lot of trouble over it because there was no mustard on it. He was right about that.
Young and Grissom splashed down 5 hours after launch. Remembering his lost Mercury capsule, Grissom refuses to open the hatch in the heaving seas until his aptly named spacecraft, the Molly Brown, is firmly secured. Grissom, in the meantime, has lost his breakfast, but not his spacecraft.
Okay, I'm out.
Okay, he's out. Hold on.
Responding to the Soviet Union's first spacewalk, astronaut Ed White steps out to greet the vastness of space on the second Gemini flight.
Okay, I rolled up, I'm rolling to the right now. Under my own influence, there goes a... Looks like a thermal thrust, Jim. Yeah. I've come above the spacecraft. I'm coming back down now. I'm under my own control.
Good, Ed, you look beautiful.
I feel like $1 million. I'm gonna pick up.
White's glide through space would be the adventure of his life. But beneath the exhilaration, a constant worry. Former spacewalker Mike Collins.
If someone outside during a spacewalk became incapacitated, even partially incapacitated, you really had no choice but to unplug them and close the hatch and come on home by yourself, because there was no way that you could get an object as large as an inflated pressure suit with an immobilized person inside stuffed back inside the small right-hand seat of a Gemini. It was hard enough when the guy inside the suit was operating at 100% capacity. He still had a tough time getting himself forced back down into that seat with enough overhead clearance to close the hatch. No one could do that for him.
Spacewalking is a major and dramatic goal in preparation for landing on the moon. But getting to the moon, landing, and returning back to Earth will be a journey taking up almost 2 weeks. Could the human body survive in a weightless environment for that long? The answer comes with two long and very unglamorous duration flights. Pete Conrad.
My
best and shortest description of Gemini 5 is 8 days in a garbage can, because first place we couldn't take off our suits, so we were in the same underwear and we were in the pressure suits the whole time. We could remove the helmets and the gloves, but we still had to live in the bulky suits, and it got to be actually quite painful. The other thing is you are weightless, and therefore your body isn't even expending energy to live in 1G. So Houston would come along at local bedtime and say, well, good night, gang, we'll see you in 8 hours, and turn off the radio, and you know, you're just sitting up there like this because you know, you just don't go to sleep, you don't need to sleep. And Gordon Cooper and I had spent the better part of a year training together, so we didn't have a lot of new sea stories to swap with one another, so there wasn't a great deal of conversation going on up there. And it just got to be probably the longest thing I've ever had to do in my life, because we literally didn't do anything for hours and hours and hours on end, and you couldn't pass the time sleeping. You just weren't sleepy.
Conrad and Cooper's ordeal is surpassed by Frank Borman and Jim Lovell on the next flight, when they begin a 14-day endurance mission in the cramped Gemini. In the midst of their mission, Wally Schirra and Tom Stafford are to join them for the first rendezvous in space. Already their flight has been delayed by the failure of an unmanned rendezvous rocket to reach orbit. Now Schirra and Stafford would experience one of the most dramatic and dangerous moments in the Gemini program.
You're cleared for takeoff.
Roger, adios.
Minus 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Ignition.
1.2 seconds after engine ignition, the Titan rocket shuts down. In an instant, Commander Schirra takes a life and death gamble. Feeling no movement with the rocket, he does nothing. If he is wrong, the 150 tons of fuel he is sitting atop will explode in a holocaust of flame.
Okay, we're just sitting here breathing.
I knew exactly what had happened, that the engine had shut down, and I knew that we had not lifted off. When in fact, all the electronic signals, the clock had started. That's the old expression you always hear someone, since Shepard, the clock has started, it's liftoff. And the clock had started, but it wasn't liftoff.
Schirra had won his gamble. Gemini 6 would fly another day. The cause of the shutdown, a small dust cap mistakenly left in the engine's fuel line. 3 days later, on the third attempt, Schirra and Stafford make their rendezvous. But in less than a day, having accomplished their objectives, Gemini 6 returns to Earth, leaving behind a lonely and discouraged Gemini 7 crew. The commander, Frank Borman.
But the grind, and I would say the last 3 days in Gemini 7 were the toughest days in my life, from the standpoint of just wanting to get out of something. It was a period in which we had used all of our attitude control fuel, so we would tumble through space until the rates got high, and then we would stabilize it and then wait to do it again. You couldn't do any experiments. We were lethargic enough at that point. Reading was a chore, and we just sort of existed for 3 days. That comes after 11 days in a very, very cramped space. It was a tough 3 days. The medical people, rightfully or wrongfully, exaggerated every possible concern every bit of the way. They were worried about blood pooling in our legs. I will remember when we got back, we were told that we would probably pass out as soon as the spacecraft righted itself. I remember looking at Jim and said, well, now we're supposed to pass out. Do you want to or not?
By 1966, NASA is confident that the astronauts can endure the effects of weightlessness for the trip to the moon. The astronauts had also proved that they could rendezvous with another object in space. The next challenge, physically docking. On Gemini 8, rookie astronauts David Scott and Neil Armstrong rendezvous and perform the first docking with an Agena rocket.
Okay, Gemini 8, we have TM solid. You're looking good on the ground. Go ahead and dock. And he's really a smoothie.
Oh, roger.
Hey, congratulations.
for your information, the Gina was very stable, and at the present time we're having no noticeable oscillations at all.
Roger. Copy, Gina, very stable and no noticeable oscillations.
Very good.
Minutes later, the two locked spacecraft begin to tumble uncontrollably.
We got serious problems here with the forward toppling end over end, but we're disengaged from the SUNA.
Believing the trouble is with the other vehicle, Armstrong pulls away. But the spinning accelerates and soon reaches a horrifying 60 revolutions per minute.
CSQ flight.
Go ahead, flight.
Did he say he could not turn the Agena off?
No, he says he is separated from the Agena and he's in a roll and he can't stop it.
Armstrong and Scott are now close to physically blacking out. In the vacuum of space, there will be no awakening.
We're low enough that we can't turn anything off. Finally, I'm creeping in a left roll.
Guessing that a thruster is somehow stuck open, Armstrong tries a desperate maneuver. By using his re-entry thrusters, he slows and steadies the spacecraft. The flight is now aborted as Gemini 8 makes an emergency splashdown in the Pacific. The man who would one day be the first to set foot on the moon had almost been one of the first to die in space. During America's second spacewalk on Gemini 9, Gene Cernan would also come face to face with the harsh realities of space.
It was a great adventure and great exposure to old Newton's laws, F equals MA. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. When you push on a spacecraft, it pushes back, and when someone touches you or you're pulled by an umbilical cord or basically a rope and it doesn't pull through your center of mass, then you start spinning in all directions. As a, for instance, when I turn a valve on the outside of the spacecraft, the valve would turn back and my body, just like I was in water, would start moving in the opposite direction. And as a result, I created a great deal of heat and moisture in my spacesuit. My spacesuit got fogged up. I was outside the spacecraft moving around the world at over 17,000 miles an hour through daytime and nighttime. And it's like driving down a freeway and my visibility was zero. I literally could not see outside my faceplate because it was fogged from the inside.
Blinded by his own exertions and still battling against weightlessness, Cernan abandons the rest of his spacewalk and seeks the safety of the Gemini.
Being a Navy pilot, it's like flying a mission and coming back to a carrier. The mission is never really over until you land aboard that carrier, and that's one of the most challenging and critical aspects of that entire mission. This was the same way. No matter what I had accomplished on that spacewalk, one of my big tasks was to be able to get back in.
It is not until Gemini 10 with John Young and Mike Collins that rendezvous, docking, and spacewalking are all three successfully achieved.
We came right into the sunlight, I guess, and we're an hour shot vehicle and then had to use a lot of propellant to get there, but we got there. And then we used that Gina that we docked with to set a new record. I guess we went up above 400 miles, and you should have seen Mike doing a spacewalk over to this other vehicle in space. I had four cameras to take a picture of this event. None of them were working. It would really, people wouldn't have believed it if they'd seen Mike on there pulling this meteorite package off the other Agena. It would have really been something.
When I got where I was going, I slipped off and I went floating, tumbling out in space. I wasn't sure where the Earth was or where the Gemini was or where the Agena was. And that was just a very exciting kind of a feeling for a minute until I finally got things back under control, and I came in, returned to the Gemini, and tried it a second time, and the second time floated over a little better and got the package and brought it back. But it's a spectacular view after a day or so of looking out of a very narrow little window. Suddenly you're actually out in the universe. There you are. It's all around you. You can see the Earth, the black sky, the Agena, the Gemini. You really feel you're in space.
Two more Gemini missions would fly, each building on the success of the other. The United States was finally ahead in the space race. After Alexei Leonov's spacewalk, not another Soviet manned mission would fly for the duration of Project Gemini. America, in the meantime, had amassed nearly 2,000 man-hours in space, compared to just over 500 for the Soviet Union. What had happened? How had the Soviet Union, once so far ahead, fallen so far behind? Jim Oberg believes that Nikita Khrushchev's emphasis on firsts was the unraveling of the Soviet space program in the 60s.
The man in space flights, one man for an hour, then another man for a whole day. The next step would have been a man for several days. But that wasn't enough of a increase in the sensational nature of the flight. So under Khrushchev demanded that two men be sent up in separate ships. After that, several men in space, two men. How about a woman in space? That, again, was something else, totally political in nature. Khrushchev made up the whole idea, told Korolev he wanted any money for the space program, better find a woman and find a way to put her into space. After that, the next step was put up three men in a space capsule to beat the American Gemini program. And that involved some particularly trying, particularly difficult engineering sacrifices to squeeze three men into what would previously have been a one-man spaceship. It was Khrushchev who demanded the space spectaculars and the stunts. It was Korolev who had to deliver. And ultimately, after several years of that, his reach exceeded his grasp, and he began to experience both technical failures, and his own health was ruined. Khrushchev himself was overthrown for that and other reasons. And at the end, it was all ashes.
Another view from Marcia Smith, U.S. Congressional Specialist on Soviet Space Activities.
Well, in a sense, most technological programs are dead ends because you learn things in one program that tell you how to do your next program better, and so you don't continue it. So the Vostok series became Voskhod, and then that series ended, and then they started with Soyuz, the same way Mercury ended, and then Gemini came, and it ended, and Apollo came, and it ended. So I'm not sure that's a downside, but it is a fact of life.
Whatever the reason, the Soviet space program had come to a near halt. In contrast, American efforts with Gemini pointed a seemingly clear path to the moon, a journey that had started in 1961 with the first manned Mercury flights. Ahead for both sides would be triumphant and tragic events. But for America, never again has the excitement and awe of space flight stirred a nation as did the adventures of the original seven Mercury astronauts. In 1984, 25 years after their first press conference, they gathered again in Houston, Texas for a reunion. There they found a public still full of wonder for men who had risked their lives in the heavens. Carpenter and Glenn flew only their one Mercury mission. Scott Carpenter shifted his attention to undersea adventure. The popular John Glenn entered national politics. Gordon Cooper flew both Mercury and Gemini flights before retiring. Wally Schirra was the only astronaut to fly Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo missions. Gus Grissom, represented by his wife Betty, died on the launch pad in the Apollo fire of 1967. Alan Shepard would be the only Mercury astronaut to walk on the moon. The medically grounded Slayton would wait 15 years before regaining flight status to fly on the final Apollo mission of Apollo-Soyuz. There are those who believe our destiny awaits us in space. If so, we owe our future in some part to these men, the wings of Mercury.
Could I see a show of hands of those of you who'd like to go up in the space shuttle?
Do two hands? Yeah.
I learned something from you.